Hi, I'm Karl.
And I'm Matthias.
And we're students from Austria working as scientific staff for the University of Life Sciences, or BOKU, in Vienna. For this year's GodoCon, we'd like to present the Landscape Lab, a landscape visualization tool based on geospatial data built entirely in Godot.
So, why is there a need for landscape visualization, you might ask? Well, for decision-making processes, participatory elements are required. Almost 60% of all information can be categorized as spatial, and 80% of all decisions in economy and administration are made on basis of spatial data. Many discussions about social issues such as landscape and climate change or the expansion of renewable energy could highly benefit from a large-scale landscape visualization in order to involve a broad public in those issues. Therefore, we used the Godot engine to create a cross-project geospatial landscape visualization tool, the Landscape Lab. The Landscape Lab uses different kinds of geodata to generically render 3D, which will be explained later. So, why Godot? Apart from that being our philosophy, in the scientific sector, licensing is a big problem. Unaffordable expenses, sometimes only for one project, are just not feasible. Furthermore, the project should be reusable for anyone interested. Another argument for Godot were mutual benefits for developers and researchers. Take from the community and give back to the community. And before we go into detail, this is how our landscape visualization looks. In this footage, a small area in Austria called Jogenland is depicted. You could move around to explore the entirety of Austria if you have the required data. The depicted chart is a result of 3 iterations with lots of learning and testing. In the process, many different architectures and methods for loading geodata were examined. The current state looks as follows. Firstly, the Godot base uses 2 GD-native implementations. One for loading geodata, called Geodot, more detail later. Another GD-native library for VR devices, which is called OpenVR. This enables VR viewing and editing with tools like a compass or a distance measurer. Our layers are inspired by QGIS, an open-source 2D geodata editor. This layer system provides a common base architecture for all implementations rather than individual, isolated, improvised modules. At the bottom, you can see the most important layer types. The basis is the terrain layer with vegetation, procedural buildings and objects such as wind turbines or park benches on top. For working with geodata, we provided different tools to analyze and manipulate geodata. Let's look into our layer structure in a bit more detail. When starting the Landscape Lab, a configurator for the layers will read the configuration. Based on its entries, a singleton called layers, which simply accesses existing data, emits signals. These signals will be interpreted. Firstly, a layer renderers configurator will instance the required renderers based on the geodata in the layer behind it. Secondly, a UI configurator will instance a UI widget which represents this layer in the UI, similar to common layer-based software such as Photoshop. This fits well into Godot's node tree. We tried our best to use the best practices mentioned in the Godot talks. Karl will tell you more on that.
So in our first iteration, we made heavy use of singletons, just because it's easy. However, this leads to spaghetti code. And at some point, it was very difficult and uncomfortable to maintain our project. So the current version, which you saw before, has minimal use of singletons, and instead we try to implement Godot's best practices. This is mainly independent encapsulated child nodes, which are managed by their parents, ideally through wiring up signals. We need a lot of multithreading because we load data at runtime. This was challenging because thread safety in Godot is not that well documented. So we contributed quite a few weird bug reports to Godot in the process of debugging our crashes. Normally, it's easy to develop and deploy Godot projects across multiple platforms, but a custom GT Native add-on makes this quite a bit more difficult, because you have to manually compile that on each platform. That's just something to keep in mind. Also, don't be afraid of shaders. They can look intimidating, but we integrated more and more custom shaders into our program because of how fast and flexible they made everything. Lastly, the Godot community offers a lot of neat open source tools, and often it's better to use and improve and contribute to those rather than building your own custom implementation.
So, I will very quickly guide you through the Landscape Lab right now. Let me actually start by showing you some in-game footage. So this is what this whole thing looks like in-game. This is a small village in Austria. So currently there's only buildings and the terrain rendered, but usually there would also be more data. So for example, here we could have a vegetation layer and this would render some trees. So this is the terrain layer. We can hide that. These are the buildings. The rest of the UI is actually just some geo-editing stuff, which I'm not going to go into detail right now. As I said, we can see the different layers that are being used in the layer UI. There's actually just the terrain and buildings, but as you can see, there's more layers. So some layers need more information to be rendered. I'm gonna go into a bit more detail about it in the code. And we can also add new layers here. So for example, add a new terrain layer, call that terrain 2, find the according data. And in this geo package, in this geo data format, there's different entries, and we choose the digital height model for the height data. And then we once again find the according data. And then we choose the ortho picture, so the satellite picture for the texture. And then we press OK. And then we hide the first terrain. So this is what this whole thing looks like while it's loading. But once it is finished, it just looks like the first terrain. And we all did that from the UI. Okay, so let's actually go into the code right now. So first of all, this is the whole world scene. So we have a world environment here. And there's also a first person, for example. So you can actually walk through the whole scene. Okay, but let's go into a bit more detail about the layers. So we have the layer renderers here. And there's like this layer singleton, which can emit signals once new layers are instanced. And if these layers are also rendered, because there's some types of layers that aren't rendered, as I mentioned, this node will react to this signal and add a new layer based on its type. So there's different types of layers. For example, I instanced a new terrain layer, but as we can see, there's different kinds of render types. So there could also be, for example, the connected object layer, which would be power poles, for example, or the vegetation layer. So as I mentioned, this would be trees or plants, but also the object layer, which would be simple park benches, for example. But we also need the render info. So this is what I talked about in the UI. A terrain render info looks as follows, for example. So here we need a height layer and a texture layer in order to render the whole terrain layer. Yeah.
Now let's go into detail on GeoDo and geospatial data in general. Geodata is just data with a spatial component, meaning it is bound to real-world coordinates. A simple example would be a map. Obviously, this is very valuable for science. Entire fields build on working with geodata. But not only that. The Microsoft Flight Simulator, for example, as well as games like Arma, show that realistic games can greatly benefit from using real-world data. And it's obvious, it's better and easier to get realistic graphics when you work with real data. And with GeoDo, you can easily load geodata into your own projects too. Now let's look at a practical example of how you might use GeoDo to load and visualize data. Here I have a QGIS project, which is just a geodata viewer, with two data types. One is an orthophoto, just satellite images, as you can see. And the other is a height map, just like you know height maps from terrain in game engines. And now I'd like to load those into a Godot project, and I have an empty project here. I just added the GeoDo add-on and created a basic mesh instance in the camera. And I'm going to add a script to the mesh instance now. And what I want to do is I want to load the data and set it on the mesh using a shader. So first, I'm going to load the height map data. And for this, I can use geodo.getRasterLayer. And I'm going to paste the path here, just because I already have it. And what this does is it gives us a raster layer object into this variable. And we can use that later to actually get our data. But first, we need some more parameters. The first is the position. And this position is projected position, so it depends on the projection of the map. That's another difficult topic, which I'm not going to go into detail right now. But basically, if you use QGIS, you can see the coordinates at the bottom here. So I'm just going to use a small portion of this, let's say 1.5 kilometers. And now I can create a geo image by calling heightmapdata.getImage. And I'll just pass the position, the size, the pixel resolution, which I'm going to use 1000 for, and the interpolation, which I'll just say 1. And now we're going to need a shader. So for this mesh instance, first I'll create a mesh, obviously, and I'm going to use a plane mesh here. And for the subdivide width and depth, I'll use the same as the resolution here, because that makes sense. So I'll say 1000 and 1000. I'm going to increase the size a bit. And now I'll create the shader. Actually, I'm going to create that here. So I'll use a new shader material, new shader. And I'm going to say shader type is spatial. And it's just going to be a simple height map shader. So I'm going to take a height map. And in the vertex function, I'll say the y position of this vertex is going to be the texture, the height map at UV, the red value, because there's only a red value in grayscale images like this. And I'm going to divide that by 150. That's just a value which tends to work at this scale, because the heights come in meters. So if you have a 10 by 10 thing here and the heights are like 200 meters high, it's going to not look too great. Right, so now that we have this, we can say mesh get surface get material, get the first material, and set the shader param. We can use the height map, which we just defined as a sampler 2D here. And we're going to call heights.getImage texture. So this here just gives us a geo image, which doesn't do much by itself. But by get image texture, we get a regular Godot image texture, which we can use anywhere where we would use an image texture. Right, so now I already put a camera into the scene. And when I start it, hopefully we're going to be able to see something. Yes, we do. We don't have any texture here, and we don't have shadows because we didn't calculate normals here. But as you can see, it did apply some of these heights. So now for loading the texture, we're going to use a very similar process. We're going to say the ortho data, and we can just copy this and slightly change the path depending on where I have stored this. So this is ortho.jpg, I think. I'm just going to make sure, actually. Yes, it is. Position and size should of course be the same, otherwise we're going to have an offset, which would be strange. And here the process is actually pretty much the same. So we can call get image on that as well. Position, same size, but for the pixel resolution, we're going to use something a bit bigger, let's say 4000, because these satellite images are much more detailed than the height samples in the height map, of course. And interpolation 1 again. And here we'll essentially do the same thing again. So we're going to say the ortho parameter is going to be ortho get image texture. And of course, we're going to have to add this to the shader as well. So we're going to use ortho with the hint albedo. Oh. And this is important because it's makes the colors correct, essentially. And in addition to this vertex shader, we're going to use a fragment shader here. This is very, very easy as well. Just texture, ortho, UV, and RGB. Right. So now when we start this, we have, quite a nice thing. It already looks like something. I'm going to add a light. If it lets me, yes. Let's just use a directional light here, just so we can see a bit better on this mesh. Oops. What am I doing? No, here. Lastly, just because this camera is kind of boring, I'm going to load in a camera asset. So let's just use this camera control script from here. I'm going to download this and install. Don't really need all of this. Just use these camera control scripts here. Right, so I'll install that. Actually, I do need a camera here to put on the script. I'm gonna get in the camera again. And that's the camera control script. And now when we start the project, can control the camera and use the arrow keys to fly through our 3D terrain. And this data isn't perfect, so when you're very close, of course, you can see that, you know, it's not ideal. The resolution is quite rough, and we don't have data for the sides here, so it's not quite as good as a Street View or Google Maps, of course. But when viewed from slightly above, it actually already looks quite good, and you can even see important landmarks. For example, if I sit here, this church at the front is quite distinct. And you know, for a few lines of code, I think this is quite valuable. Now, for those who are interested in the design of the add-on itself, let's talk a bit about how that works behind the scenes. First of all, GDAL is a major part of GeoDo. It's a powerful library for processing geodata, and it's often used by scientists in the field, especially when it's integrated into other programs or with the Python bindings. However, the G++ base can also be used directly, and that's what we do here. Here you can see the structure of the add-on. It has three major layers, aside from Godot and the geodata itself. Godot talks to the GD native module, which doesn't directly talk to GDAL, but it has custom processing libraries in between. This is just because maintaining C++ code is hard, especially when you have two huge dependencies, Godot and GDAL. So we split it up. The GD native bindings are only dependent on Godot, while the processing libraries only depend on GDAL. And in between those, we use our own custom types or default C++ types. That gives us a lot of control and makes maintaining as well as collaborating on the project much easier. Now, to give you an idea of how the structure works, let's look at a specific example. What happens when loading a geo-referenced image into Godot, as we did earlier? First, we open the whole file as a geo-raster layer. That's the GD native class. And behind the scenes, it holds a native layer, which again holds a GDAL dataset. This GDAL dataset provides access to a geotiff file, but it doesn't actually load it into RAM, so large files are no problem as well. Next, we call get image on that layer, which we retrieved earlier, and we get a geo image object, which refers to a geo raster object in the raster processor, and underneath that, there's a GDAL dataset again. GeoImages essentially just wrap the GDAL dataset differently, for example, with values like position and size, which we passed when getting them. And now something actually happens. We call getImageTexture on the GeoImage, and let's read this from the bottom up. We want a section of a GeoTIFF, and GDAL's raster IO function reads that efficiently. Actually, even files with a size of hundreds of gigabytes are no problem, as this only accesses the relevant blocks. The result is a simple C++ array, which the processing library passes to the GDNative part. And here, the data is turned into a Godot image with some funky array magic, and that image is wrapped by an image texture. And we're done. We can use the image texture in our meshes or other sprites. So what can you do with this as a scientist? Obviously, as shown before, landscape visualization. You can visualize not only the present, but also the past using historical data, or the future in order to examine potential changes to a landscape. You can't only visualize landscapes as well, but also more abstract data, such as weather graphs, land or building utilization, or population density. Simulation has a huge potential as well. You can do real-time 3D simulation and visualization of real-world events. For example, with the physics engine, you could roughly estimate natural disasters, such as flooding and avalanches. But the real potential here is probably in the more mundane things, like shadow casting on a building depending on where the sun is. All of this is especially relevant for communication. Science is often not very approachable for outsiders due to the obscure tools and abstract results they use internally. An interactive simulation and visualization can make it much easier for outsiders to understand and work with scientific results. With Godot, you could even gamify them. But, as I said, there are also many interesting ways you could use real-time geodata as a game developer. So most obviously, you can easily get realistic terrain. You can either use that directly, for example in simulation games, like a flight simulator, or you can use it as a fast prototype to tweak later on. That way you can load whole mountain ranges with very high detail and realism with quite little work. And I'm sure that some of you have other interesting ideas as well. So I hope Geodo sparks some interest in experimenting with real data. And that leads us to the overall conclusion.
We're continuing to work on the Landscape Lab for a new research project, so more features will follow. Continuation worked well partly because of the Godot license for the reasons explained before. The use of Godot in scientific context in general appears very adequate, plus it is free to use. The future of geodata in game development seems prosperous. MS Flight Simulator shows the potential. Maybe we can bring some of that to Godot. The broad community, which makes potential pitfalls easier to resolve, is a good reason to choose Godot over other game engines. Also, with this presentation, we wanted to showcase that the use of Godot extends just gaming. You can actually create serious software. So, in conclusion, try it and contribute. Note, however, that this project is work in progress, so open up issues if you can't get it to work. But also let us know about possible features you are interested in, or open pull requests if you have the motivation to contribute. Hopefully, we were able to demonstrate how and why Godot might be used in a scientific context and aroused some interest in geodata in some of you game developers as well.
Thank you for listening.